Father, thank you so much for this time that we have to share the word from which we share and your people with whom we share your word. Today we ask that you would let revelation knowledge flow. Share your heart, reveal your mind, and any way you bless us, we will be satisfied. We thank you right now for just being God to us in every way, in every way, every aspect, in every area of our lives. You've proven yourself to be more than faithful. Now, God, speak to us in a way that is indisputably you. Give us clarity, God. Give us encouragement to continue to move forward in trusting you. Thank you for stabilizing us with the gift of faith. And thank you for fortifying us, God, with the power of your Spirit. It is in the name of Jesus we pray and we boldly declare the devil is defeated. God, you are exalted in Jesus. You are Lord. And I will agree with the prayer of the man of God. Shout it, hallelujah. Amen. And thank you, Jesus. Come on, put those hands together and give God a hand clap of praise. Just touch yourself and say, dream again. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Well, good morning, family.
Good morning.
My brothers and my sisters, at the outset of this message, I want to say to you that one of the often forgotten distinguishing works of the Holy Spirit in the season of Pentecost is the phenomenon of men having dreams and seeing visions. The Apostle Peter stands up on the historic day, 50 days after the crucifixion of Christ, 47 days after his resurrection. He quotes the words of prophet Joel in his explanation of what had happened in the upper room. And he says to them that Joel says, your young men shall have visions and your old men shall dream dreams. In Joel's description of Pentecost, it is interesting that we ought to note that the season of dreams and visions comes after a God-ordained preceding season of darkness, destruction, and devastation. According to the prophet Joel, years have been devoured by swarming locusts. Years have been devoured by crawling locusts. Years have been devoured by the palm worm, and years have been devoured by the caper worm. I thought it was interesting that he did not say that stuff was devoured. He said that years had been devoured. Before I go any further, I need to speak to every man, every father in here under the sound of my voice, who feels like he had lost years. I need to speak to every man who feels as if your best days are behind you. I need to speak to every man in here who may have some sort of regret because you did not spend your time in your past in the best way that you should have. God sent me here today to prophetically declare that he's about to restore the years that you lost. That may not mean anything to you if you have not wasted time. It may not mean anything to you if you have not mismanaged seasons. It may not mean anything to you if you have, through foolery and foolishness, not made the most of every opportunity that God gave you. But I'll stop right here and shout, and I don't need to say any more, because God has just promised me that he's going to restore the grace. I wish you would tell somebody and say, you're about to get some time back. You're about to get time back that you mismanaged. You're about to get time back that you just threw away. You're about to get time back that you just kind of wrote off. You're about to get time back that you didn't act right in. You're about to get time back that you didn't make the right decisions. You're about to get time back when you made the wrong move. I need somebody in here. I'm feeling better now. I need somebody in here to give God praise, because God just promised you that after the darkness and after the devastation and after all the destruction that you experienced, even if it was your fault, God have mercy, he's getting ready to restore the time. Can I get anybody in here to shout right now? Everybody in here who ain't never mismanaged nothing, be seated. Everybody in here who ain't never messed nothing up, just stay quiet. But everybody in here who can look back over your life and say, if I had had it to do all over again, I would have done it differently. You ought to be giving God some glory right now, because he promised you that he was going to restore the years. Guess what? If he gives you the years back, the stuff ain't nothing. I said, oh, y'all, that's what I said. If God can give you the years back, he can give you the stuff back too. Somebody take 15 seconds and praise God for your season of restoration. God said, and this is really interesting, I'm not going to preach real long, God said something that blows my mind, Saret. He says that the caramel worm, the canker worm, the crawling locust, and the swarming locust were the army that I sent. Which means the author behind all of the devastation, the destruction, and all of the darkness was God himself. Which leads me to ask this question. Why would God order destruction and devastation in order to provoke a man to dream? Well, I'm glad you asked. There are three reasons, and I'm going to wobble, wobble, and drop it like it's hot. Number one, darkness and devastation bring a man face to face with the consequences of his sinful behavior. Men, we need to understand that God loves us so much that he does not let us get away with things that could ultimately destroy us. A sign of God's love is that God chastens who he loves, and he scourges everyone that he receives. So that whenever we experience darkness and devastation, it brings us face to face with the consequences of our sinful behavior. I don't know about you, but I'm glad that God has the ability to stop me in my tracks. I'm glad that God will not allow me to go too far, to get too far out there, that I cannot find my way back. Darkness and devastation that God ordains is God's way of stopping you, watch this, and helping you to check yourself before you wreck yourself. But then secondly, God ordains or orders destruction and devastation to provoke men to dream, because darkness and devastation bring a man, watch this, face to face with God's eternal mercy. Which is to suggest that God is so merciful that he will not allow whatever it is that you did by way of self-destructive behavior to keep you in a pattern, watch this, wherein you continue on that path. He is so merciful, somebody ought to shout, he's merciful. He's merciful that he can overlook the things that it is that you did that were against him, and still show you, watch this, that my mercy endures forever. Now maybe that doesn't mean anything to you, but when I look back over my life, I understand that I am not here because I'm good. I'm here because of his mercy. I have not survived because I've been squeaky clean. I've survived because of his mercy. I have not, watched this, ascended to places that I've ascended because I'm so slick, so smart, and so astute. But I am where I am because of the mercy of God. I'm so glad that God's mercy outlasts any of my mess. And I believe there are a few men in you who can join me in praising God for that. And perhaps some women who have the testimony that God's mercy outlasts your mess. I tried to tell you last week that his anger is but for a moment. But his favor or his mercy endures for life. I'm getting ready to do a pew check real fast. Is there anybody in here besides me who has testimonies of the ever-enduring mercy of God? Is there anybody in here who has a testimony that God has been kinder to you than you've been to him? Is there anybody in here who has a testimony, watch this, that says even when you were not faithful to him, God was faithful to you?
Yeah.
Don't fool me now. Is there anybody in here who can look back and see that the destruction and the devastation and the darkness that you experienced, watch this, it did not last always. And God did not let up off of it simply because you were that good. He let up off of it simply because he is that good. I need somebody in here to praise God along with the psalmist who says his mercy endures forever. And the reason I become overly animated and demonstrative and beside myself when I begin to talk about the mercy of God is because I realize that his mercy endures forever. That may not make none of y'all shout, but it gives me chills up and down my spine. Which says to me that I can't be so jacked up that God's mercy will not suit my case. I cannot get too far away from him that his mercy can't come back and grab me. I wish I had somebody in here which would take 30 seconds and just praise God. Watch this. For his ever-enduring mercy. His mercy kept me when I was about to OD or some stuff. And other people died. His mercy kept me when I put myself in harm's way. His mercy kept me when I wanted to run for him, but he wouldn't let me go. His mercy kept. Is there anybody in here who can lift your hands, open your mouth, and shout, thank you, God, for your mercy? And devastation will bring, listen to me, fellas, will bring a man face to face with God's eternal mercy, which is to suggest this third thing, that darkness and devastation will always bring a man face to face with God's irrevocable purpose. In other words, the purpose of God cannot be revoked, that the purpose of God cannot be changed. The purpose of God is eternal. It is set in stone. God never changes his mind about you. And darkness and devastation will bring you to the place where you understand that no matter how dark, how devastated, no matter how much destruction you've experienced, God's purpose is still sure. Ah, God. In other words, he does not change his mind. I've been trying to press this in on y'all for the past year, that God has not changed his mind about you. And God lets it get dark, Nikki, just to show you that he doesn't change his mind about you. People change their mind about you, but God doesn't. Your circle around you may change their mind, but God doesn't. People will often give up on you based upon circumstantial evidence when God has the hard proof of how dark you've been, and still he does not change his mind. Maybe there's some men in here who can testify with me that you're glad that God's purpose is still sure. That you're glad that he has not changed his mind about who he created you to be. And even if your eyes are plucked out and your hair has been cut off, Samson, God will cause you to walk still in purpose. And all you got to do is find the pillars of your life and understand that, watch this, that God has not given up on you, and you can be victorious even when the enemy thought he had you. Is there anybody in here besides
besides me who has a testimony, but you got victory even when the enemy thought he had you. I wish you would touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, it got dark in my life when I understood that the darkness in my life did not impact my purpose. And all I had to do was re-embrace my purpose. And when I re-embraced my purpose, I had victory. Now, some of you in here looking at me right now, if you had this mic, you could tell the same story. The darkness did not go away, watch this, until you embraced your purpose. You didn't have anybody to help you out of your last mess. You just embraced your purpose. You didn't have anybody to pray you out of your last hole. You just embraced your purpose. There was nobody lifting you up and encouraging you, but you heard God telling you that my purpose is still sure in your life. And it was the purpose that gave you victory. Is there anybody besides me who knows what it's like to bounce back because you realize that God was not true with you yet? I wish you would grab one more neighbor, and I'm going to let you leave your neighbor alone. But I wish you would just touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, the reason I get up every morning and start my day off with a hallelujah on my lips is because I realize that God is not done with me yet. The reason I came in here to church today was not to see or to be seen. I came here because I realized that if the enemy had had his way last night, I would have been dead and sleeping in my grave. But the moment I opened my eyes, I realized that God was not done with me yet. And when I look back out of everything that God has brought me through, the source of my praise is that God is not finished with me. I wish you would encourage somebody beside you and say, the devil is a lie. God is not finished with you. All you got to do is embrace your purpose again. I don't care how far you've gotten away, embrace your purpose again. I don't care how far you've strayed, embrace your purpose. Am I talking to anybody in here? If you can praise God because you still got purpose. Just three people say, neighbor, please excuse me for about 15 seconds. I'm going to praise God because I still got purpose. I'm in pain, but I still got purpose. I've missed it, but I still got purpose. My life has been hard, but I still got purpose. The enemy has been messing with me, but I still got purpose. I've lost some things, but never lost my purpose. Lost some people, but never lost my purpose. Somebody lift your hand and shout, God, I thank you that I still have my purpose.
When we look, I'm almost done. When we look at the latter years of Jacob, it looks like Jacob's life has totally fallen apart. Text lets us know that he thinks that his youngest, his favorite son, Joseph, is dead. It lets us know that his youngest son, Benjamin, has been taken away. But when we look carefully at Jacob's life, here is what we will find. We will find that Jacob's life has been one turbulent event after another. He has lived his life not in the power of his grandfather Abraham, not in the ease of his father Isaac, but since the day of Jacob's birth, he has been living his life in turbulence. He's been fighting with his brother Esau. He has not been his father's favorite. All his life, he's had to fight. He's had to struggle. But when you look at his life, watch this. This is going to mess some of y'all up. He is, watch this, he is the object of reversed sexual exploitation. Most often we talk about women who are sexually exploited. But when you look at Jacob's life, Jacob is sexually exploited himself. For the text lets us know that Rachel and Leah, his sisters, who were also his wives, were in competition
God, I'm going to talk with y'all when we're doing it. Were in competition for Jacob's affection. And they both wanted to have children by him. And when Leah saw that Jacob's affection had been turned towards Rachel, listen to what Leah does. Leah sends her son with some mandrakes, pays Rachel so that Rachel will let Jacob sleep with her. Y'all miss what I'm saying? God, we don't even want to talk about the history of black men who have been sexually exploited. Oh, God. I'm just going to get quiet here. We don't want to talk about the history of men who have not always been the pursuers, but have been pursued for the purposes or the selfish purposes of the women who pursued them. All right, let me go a little further. I don't want to talk about this. We don't want to talk about the fact that like Black Joseph, who was pursued by Potiphar's wife, Jacob, his father, was also exploited sexually. I guess I'm trying to speak to the men and the fathers in here to help you understand, and watch this, that you are far more than a money provider and a sperm donor. I need to speak. Okay, God, I'm sorry. Am I getting too deep for y'all this morning? I need to speak to every man in here who has been looked at as someone who can simply serve the whims of the women in your life without being honored, watch this, and dignified for being who you are. You are far more than a protoplasm that produces a serum that produces children. You are created by God in his image and in his likeness, which means that not only are you a provider, but you are a protector. And you are also one, watch this, who if you realize what your purpose is, when you get in line with your purpose, you can shift the entire trajectory of a culture. I'm praying for men today to see themselves through the lens of God. I'm praying for men today to see themselves as who God has created them to be. As a matter of fact, I need you to just encourage some man beside you and tell that man that you are who God created you to be. You are more than somebody who can provide money and who can provide, I'm open for the opportunity, and who can provide some sort of comfort and contentment for everyone who's around you. You are to be honored and esteemed as one who has been created in God's image and likeness. I wish we would start celebrating men for being who God has created them to be. Because not all of us are out here acting crazy. There's some of us who are sincere about what God has assigned us to do. And I came to preach to some brother in here to let you know that many times we are victims of circumstances. We are victims of how we have been treated. But God said there's getting ready to be a shift in the way you see yourself. And if you can see yourself in a different light, everybody around you is going to see you differently as well. I need somebody in here to celebrate the men in your life who may not be perfect, but they are coming closer to becoming what God has created them to be on a daily basis. I need you to celebrate a man who is beaten up by society, objectified by his own community, beaten down by his own power sometimes, but in spite of it all, he chooses to see himself through the lens of God, and he may not be all that he ought to be, but he's becoming what God has created him to be on a daily basis. Come on, give God praise for the real men who know how to find purpose and walk after God's purpose.
Yeah.
Three things I'm going to close, because the text says Israel took his journey with all that he had. And he came to Beersheba. Somebody shout, Beersheba. And he offered sacrifices to the God of his father Isaac. Here's what's interesting in about Beersheba. Beersheba is called the well of oaths. We see it, first of all, in the book of Genesis chapter 20, when his grandfather Abraham comes in contact with a man by the name of Abimelech. If y'all remember, as they were traveling through Egypt, Abraham says to his wife Sarah, "Sarah, I need you to tell the king of the region that you are not my wife, that you are my sister." She agrees, and watch this, the king comes and he takes Sarah to be a part of his harem. While he has Sarah in his harem, God begins to deal with Abimelech and says to Abimelech, "Don't touch that woman because she belongs to Abraham." The text also lets us know that Abimelech approaches Abraham and says to him, "Why did you lie to me and say this was your wife, your sister, and not your wife?" Abraham said, "I thought that if you knew who she was to me, you would kill me and take her." Notice what happens. God switches things around. Because God says to Abimelech, if you touch her, all of y'all are going to die. Abimelech cannot figure out why, watch this, in Abraham's era, God still blesses him. I wish you would touch your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, there are times that God has blessed me when I know I've been in error." Oh God, I wish you would touch somebody else and say, "Neighbor, this ain't for the religious, this is for the righteous." But there are times that God blessed me when I knew I was jacked up. And it was because God had made an oath that he was going to bless me, watch this, in the entirety of my life. I wish you would grab your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, I can't give you all the details, but God has blessed me in ways that it has blown my mind. And when I thought God should have been done with me, he proved himself to be the God of his word." Is there anybody in here besides me who can praise God for being the God of his word? When it looked like he should have been done with me, he still kept his word. I ain't going to actually touch a neighbor too many more times, but I wish you would touch one neighbor and say, "Neighbor, he kept his word when it looked like he should have been done with me." But watch this, at Beersheba, Isaac, his father, does the same thing. When Isaac comes through the land in Genesis 26, the Bible says that when Isaac gets there, Abimelech approaches him. He says to Rebekah, "Rebekah, don't tell him that you're my wife. Tell him that you're my sister." And the same fate that came upon Abraham came upon Isaac. In other words, when it looked like God should have withdrawn his hand, God blessed him just the same. I guess I'm trying to say to some of y'all in here that some of you are living under a generational blessing of your father. Many of us have talked about generational curses, but some of you have blessings that are on your life from your father. Watch this. That God said, because of who your father was, I'm going to bless you just for his sake. Is there anybody besides me? I was in tears this morning because I begin to think about how much God is blessing me. Watch this. Not for my sake, but for daddy-long's sake. And is there anybody in here who can look back at big daddy or whatever you call your family? and he worshiped. Fellas, I need y'all to help me one more time. Because a man that worships, can I preach in here for a minute? A man that worships will eventually start seeing what God has purposed for his life. A man who worships is a man who will have his dreams and his visions restored. A father who worships is a father who will begin to see everything that God has purposed for his life manifest. A man who worships is a man who will begin to see the hand of God move even in the dark seasons of his existence. I think I'm going to close this lesson right here. But I need right now every man to stand back on your feet and to lift your hands in worship to God. And I'm going to close it right here. I need every man just to lift your hands and begin to worship. Play now. Every man, lift your hands and begin to worship. Open your mouth and begin to worship God. Because God told me to tell you today that you're getting ready to dream again. You're getting ready to see again what he showed you before your season of darkness. You're getting ready to see again what he showed you. Watch this. Before you went through the devastation, you're getting ready to see again what he showed you before you went through the season where it looked like you couldn't come out of the darkness of your life. He's getting ready to show you once again everything. He's going to show you that he has not given up on you. He's getting ready to show you that your sons and your daughters are going to be okay. He's going to show you. He's going to show you the manifestation of every promise that he made you. I got more message to give you, but I just feel God calling men to worship, men to worship, men to worship, men to worship. And brothers, I don't know, will y'all please join me at the altar, please?